Turn it off mute. There we go. Good morning. one or two notices. You can tell things are starting to get back to normal when we've got notices. Hopefully it means things are going on. First of all, I'd just like to say a huge thank you to those who came along to help clean church yesterday. I had somebody with me this morning from another church who is doing a bit of training with me, and she said, "Oh, doesn't it look sparkly and wonderfully well kept and cared for?" And I said, "Well, we had a team of people here yesterday doing some spring clean, but generally our church is well cared for and kept nice and clean and whatever." So I thought that was a wonderful thing for her to say, but a huge thank you to those who came along. It was a select few people, but a huge thank you to them. Ted, I've got bands of marriage. Where's Ted? I've got no bands book here. I've got bands of marriage, I believe. Is that right, Christine? They're done. Oh, right, okay, they're done. I must have done them last week then. Wrong church. Mother in Sunday, members of the Mothers Union invite you to donate to their annual Mother's Day appeal. There's a box at the back of church there if you want some information about that. Somebody in the Mothers Union will be able to tell you. Trying to look at who's here from the Mothers Union. No one. I could tell you a bit about it if you want to know what it is. We're also raising funds for Ukraine. There will be a coffee morning in the chapter house on the 26th of March, 10:30 to 12. Tea, coffee, baked cakes and biscuits. And if you've given up cakes and biscuits for Lent, we will let you off for that one. I'll give you absolution from that. I think, seriously, if you have given up cakes and biscuits for Lent, then come and have a cup of coffee. Or if you do want to partake in cake, I think if your intent is for something good, I think that's fine. I don't think that breaks your Lenten promise. We'll see it as a festival or something. We also got the big jar at the back of church, which we're trying to raise money for the Ukraine at the moment. We have an online collection too. And anything that you give through the card machine will go to the Ukraine as well. That's set up for that too. There are lots of other notices within the order of service there. Just a date for your diary. The festival weekend of flowers, music, arts and crafts is on the 13th to the 15th of May. Do pop that in your diary. It will be a great weekend, and there'll be more details coming out probably next week, the next week or so, about that. I think that's all in the notices. So we're going to begin by singing the first of our hymns for this morning, hymn number 397, Let Us With Gladsome Mind, and we're going to omit verses 4 and 5.
Thank you.
and to light this candle. For the people of Ukraine. As we pause in the silence, we remember those fleeing from war-torn places, families and children displaced, afraid, for those who are trapped in places of alleged safety, for those buried under the rubble of a theatre, which was supposed to be a safe refuge. For those who have lost loved ones, and for the torment and terror that many people are experiencing in their lives. As we see it day in and day out on the news, it's easy to become accustomed to the bombing and to the destruction of people's lives. And we stand united with the people of Ukraine, that they may live in their country in peace and we pray that peace may reign in that place. So we hold these our prayers this day. Amen. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We have come together as the family of God in our Father's presence to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins and to seek his grace, that through his Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. And so we pray together. Lord, direct our thoughts, teach us to pray, lift up our hearts to worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ. Amen. Lent is a time self-examination, a time of confession, a time to bring before God the things not quite right within our lives. And in our sermon today, we will hear about not just asking forgiveness for, but turning towards God. Not just being absolved of the things that we've done wrong, but having a complete change of heart for the things that are not quite right within our lives. Not that we might feel better for release of those things, but that we might have life, and life to the fullest. As we sit or kneel, we pray before God. Make our hearts clean, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Father eternal, giver of light and grace, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour in what we have thought, said, and done, and in what we have left undone. Through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, we have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and lead us out from darkness to walk as children of light. Amen. So Christ give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, take up your cross and follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. So we come to our first reading for this morning.
The reading is taken from Isaiah, chapter 55. Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you, because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their way, and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, said the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So let us stand and sing from the yellow books, number 25, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord.
Come now, in forever and
The Gospel is taken from Luke, chapter 13. At that very time, there were some present who told him about the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. He asked them, "Do you think that because these Galileans suffered in this way, they were worse sinners than other Galileans?" "No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish as they did." Or those 18 who were killed when the Tower of Siloam fell on them. Do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others living in Jerusalem? "No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all perish just as they did." Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" He replied, "Sire, let it alone for one more year until I dig round it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be. So let us hear our Lord's blessing on those who follow him. "Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be satisfied.
Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God.
Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God.
Blessed are those who suffer persecution for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven."
May I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. There's a fancy theological term for the question, how can a good and loving God allow bad things happen to people? And the term is, anybody want to hazard a guess what that is? No? Theodicy. Don't worry, there won't be a test when you go. You don't have to remember the term. But the first thing that we think of when catastrophes happen, especially when they happen to us or people we know or people that we can associate with or people that are innocent, is why does God allow evil to thrive? How can God just stand by and watch us as hundreds of people are killed by Russian bombs and missiles in the Ukraine? How can someone who has never smoked a single cigarette die from lung cancer? How does a perfectly healthy young mother who's devoted her life to ministry die abruptly? Where is God in all that suffering? They aren't rhetorical questions. Good people who have trusted in God their entire lives have asked these hard questions. And it's easy to blame God for circumstances that are beyond our control. If God is really in control and he lets terrible things happen to people, well, the only logical explanation must be that somehow they deserved it. God must be punishing us for something we've done when bad things happen. Right? It's the only way we can make sense of it. Don't be fooled by catastrophe and tragedy, those terrible things that happen to people, like having a tower fall on you or a serious accident. Things like that can make you question where God is in the midst of suffering. And it's easy to lash out at God and blame the creator of the universe for allowing bad things to happen. After all, if we blame God, he takes the responsibility off us. We can allow ourselves to be distracted by the things we can't control instead of doing something about the things that we can. Why did this happen? It's too easy to ask, wringing our hands as we sit on the sidelines and do nothing, change nothing, influencing and affecting nothing. It's easy to shrug our shoulders and say that it's all God's fault and I can't do anything about it. But when his followers ask Jesus the theodicy question, it makes it clear that catastrophic events aren't God's punishment. Those people aren't any worse sinners than you or me. Luke mentions repentance more time than any other repentance in his book, more times than any other book of the Bible. In fact, close to more often than the rest of the New Testament combined. Repentance is a major theme during this season of Lent. It's a major theme for Luke too. We talk about repentance as an act of turning completely around 180 degrees to leave our sins behind us. We also say that repenting requires being sorry for our sin. But I think repentance is much more than telling God we're sorry. Repentance isn't just saying you're sorry for what you've done wrong. It requires turning or changing. But repentance is not just a behaviour modification. So often we think that repentance needs to be some dramatic sin that we've ceased doing or some kind of bad behaviour we need to turn away from. Well, that might be true for some of us. But it's more likely that you don't consider yourself that kind of sinner. Your sins aren't very dramatic. You can manage your home behaviour without too much help. Hold that in mind as we near Jerusalem, as we think of repentance in terms of who we are, run into more than what we turn away from. So if we think of the repentance in the terms of who we are turning to more than who we are running away from, it flips repentance around. So instead of heading down the rabbit hole of theodicy and blaming God for all the bad things that happened to us, or offering hollow apologies, or thinking of repentance as some bad sort of self-help program to help our behavior, we need to focus on the voice of Jesus. Our repentance needs to become more a deep desire to listen to him, especially when we find ourselves in the middle of a catastrophe. So this story really isn't about theodicy, it's about repentance. And it's been true all through this season of Lent. As we have turned our ears to listen to Jesus and get close to him, here he says it plainly, not once, but twice. Now I tell you, but unless you repent, you will perish just as they did. And when Jesus says, unless you repent, you will die as they did, he doesn't mean like a tower is going to fall on you. Your blood is not going to be mixed with some of the animal sacrifices' blood. And unlike some scholars, I don't think, as they did, it suggests that they were somehow not right with God when they died. Maybe because their tragic end was so abrupt, they didn't have a chance to confess their sins to be absolved of them. I think Jesus was making the point that the tragedy of these deaths was not in their gruesomeness, but in their pointlessness. Unless you repent, in other words, your life will be pointless as their deaths were. If you want your life to have a point, if you want to find meaning, if you want to have a life that has clear purpose, repentance is the key. If we flip repentance and think of it as turning towards Jesus, instead of just turning away from sin, then something else happens. Instead of repentance being all about what we do to make ourselves acceptable to God, we suddenly find ourselves basking in God's grace. Repentance is a response to the goodness God has done, and not a requirement to merit God's goodness. I wonder what it feels like to be considered a problem. Our hospitals or nursing homes and jails are filled with people who might think they've been written off or dismissed or rendered invisible. As teen suicide rates climb, it would probably add schools to that list of institutions where people may have lost hope. Jesus says, wait a minute, let me do some fertilizing here. Let me dig into the hardened earth and loosen it up a bit so that the roots can breathe. Let's not give up quite yet. There's hope that life can be fruitful. Christ calls us to the kind of repentance that turns our affection away from ourselves and points our attention towards God. Instead of trying to improve ourselves in order to merit God's love, Christ offers that love to us freely and says, here, receive this gift. Let me enrich your soil with some manure. Let your repentance become the compost that fertilizes new life. God's judgment is given, whatever tragedies we may experience, and the answer to tragedy is repentance towards God. When bad things happen, Jesus encourages us to turn to God instead of blaming God. Those poor souls who died violent deaths didn't deserve to die like that because of some evil they'd done. Bad things happen. But how we respond to them determines whether or not our lives will be as pointless as those deaths. We can wallow in self-pity, or we can repent towards God and live. Amen.
So let us stand to affirm our faith. Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore God has raised him on high, and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
So we may stand in to sing hymn number 294, Just As I Am.
Jesus, remember me when you come. the Spirit, and together, in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. You promise, Lord, to hear us when we pray in faith. We pray for our church, for the world, for those we love, and for ourselves. There are difficult days ahead for us all. The war in Ukraine is so close, and its effect upon our lives has become, and will increasingly become, a huge challenge, felt more closely day by day. We pray for a meaningful peace, but do not doubt that we will all be needed to play a part in the outcome, whether it's providing hospitality to the refugees or support for the resolution of any settlement. It may take many forms and maybe personal sacrifice. Rising prices of energy and basic food essentials are already falling to the most vulnerable. Let our church voice be heard loudly and provide the leadership of compassion that is needed. May our nation's leaders show humility, restraint, and clear thinking in their negotiations for peace. And may it be done quickly. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We give thanks that our church here at St. Robert's is blessed. We have leaders with compassion and Christian hearts. We give thanks for Reverends Nick and John and our bishops Helen, Anne and Nick. For our readers this morning who bring us the gospel. For those who work behind the scenes who make church happen. For our wonderful choir and our organist. Our administrators, food providers, our volunteers who keep our church clean and tidy, and for those who offer us a warm welcome. We all play our part and are the body of Christ in this place. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, how you must despair at the way your gift of the world is mismanaged. Wars, pandemic, and environmental crises fill our news, and the weight of worry can sometimes seem unbearable. It is hard to discover God's goodness in these times of distress. But there is so much to give thanks for. We've seen heroic humanitarian efforts to help refugees. COVID vaccines are not just offering protection, but opening treatment opportunities for other illnesses and restoring life to normal. Not using Russian oil means dependent countries developing environmental alternatives. And who could not appreciate the warming spring sunshine this weekend? The birdsong and the flowers. These may seem small blessings, dear Lord, and in such overwhelming circumstances, but blessings they are. And for these we give our thanks. Lord, continue to pour out your Holy Spirit upon your undeserving world and bring your peace upon all who suffer. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for our families, for those who are close, and for those far away. We pray for loved ones who may find themselves in dangerous places. We pray particularly for faith groups and aid workers who are risking their lives today for others. We pray for those hurting and those who struggle to see the way ahead. There is no bravery in struggling alone. Confide your pain. Perhaps you are seeing the pain in someone you love, someone close to you.
Give us the presence of mind to hold out our hand, a hand of friendship, a hand of care and love for one another. Hold them tightly in your heart now as we pray for healing. We pray especially for the children, their world being so dramatically changed through the disruptions. Protect them from the vagaries of life in this world and the things they see on social media and TV that sometimes feel so far from the light of life, the light of the Lord. Surround them with your love and let us guide them in your example. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We live in this moment. It is a time given by God. It is a Lenten time, and he prepares us for this moment. Continue to be faithful to his word. Trust that all will be well. Remember to pray and to give thanks for his mercies. You are ready. Allow God in to do his work within you. Then you will rise high in all that you can do for him. In return, you will have God's peace. Merciful Father, accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Upon us and grant us thy salvation.
O Lord, save the Queen,
and mercifully hear us when we call upon thee.
Endue thy ministers with righteousness,
and make thy chosen people joyful.
O Lord, save thy people,
and bless thine inheritance.
Give peace in our time, O Lord,
because there is none other that fighteth for us, but only thou, O God.
O God, may clean our hearts within us,
and take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
Eternal God, give us the insight to discern your will for us, to give up what harms us, and to seek the perfection we are promised in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
This is love, not that we love God, loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son. He is the sacrifice of our sins, that we might live through him. If God loves us so much, we ought to love one another. If we love one another, God lives in us. The blessing of God Almighty passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you, those whom you love, those who need your love, this day and for the days to come. In the name of Christ. Amen. To sing our final hymn, hymn number 368, Guide Me, O Thy Great Redeemer.
To love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.